forget, this is the first of a new month, so this coming Tuesday evening will be our monthly night out, and the ladies are still over at Beef O'Brady's, the men at Bill's Barbecue at 6 o'clock. What? She uses that excuse every week. All right. So anyway, just put that on your calendar. Of course, Crass for a Cause on Tuesday morning. However, the good news is that since our memory verses, the Great Commission from last month, was a little lengthy, we're going to hold it over. It's been held over due to popular request for one more month. That would be verse 18. All authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. So. Well, maybe I should have done it that way. All right. Let's worship the Lord this morning. Hymn number 347. Lord, I lift your name on high. Hymn number 347. Lift your name on high. Before the Lord in prayer, and I'm going to ask Brother Mac if you would lead us in prayer this morning. Amen. All right. Now, if we can get that kid that was singing soprano wherever. No. Not even trying. Not those notes. Not an octave or two, a little bit deeper. All right. Hymn number 382 we're going to sing this morning. Serve the Lord with gladness. Hymn number 382.
Till Jesus comes.
As I mentioned earlier, our September memory verse, same as for August. How many of you remember the rock group back from the 60s, Herman's Hermits? Henry VIII? Yep, second verse, same as the first. All right. Okay. Matthew 28, 18. Well, I lost you. Matthew 28, 18 through 20. All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Matthew 28, 18 through 20. And again, if you haven't memorized already, even to the end of the world, that's okay too. Because guess what? The world will end, guess when? At the end of the age. All right. You got that and figured out? Interesting how you come to this conclusion. Always trying to figure out an easier way. I actually read somewhere, I don't remember if maybe it was Elon Musk or I don't know who it was that said this. Apparently I saw a quote from them just a few days ago that said, if you want a job done, said hire a lazy person to do it, because a lazy person will always find an easier way to do it. Not that Merrill is lazy. Okay, let's continue with our worship today. All right, hymn number 622, as we sing our offertory hymn today, all four verses of Satisfied with Jesus, hymn number 622. Let's stand together as we sing our offertory hymn today.
I am satisfied with Jesus. He has done so much for me. Suffered to satisfied with me.
Good morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we just thank you for this beautiful morning, dear Lord. Just thank you for the church, dear Father, and just fill it with the Spirit, dear Lord. Be with Pastor William as he gives you a word. And just let us open our hearts and mind to learn from the word, dear Lord. Be with our tithes and offerings and just have your hand upon them to do the work of the church and beyond the doors of the church. And again, we just thank you and praise you for who you are. You're such an awesome God. We just pray these things, holy and blessed name, Jesus. Amen.
I'm going to ask you, if you will, this morning to turn in your Bibles to the Epistle of 2 Thessalonians. Now, one of the effects of the curse of sin that has been placed on humanity because of Adam and Eve's sin, well, specifically, this one was blamed on Adam, is that when we work, that unlike what God's intention for good, honest, hard work was supposed to be, that work turned into labor. That it's back-breaking, sweat-inducing, hard labor. Nevertheless, the Bible says that a good day's worth of work is good for us. And we'll find in this passage of Scripture that we're going to read here in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 that hard work is both godly and biblical. By the way, the ideas that a lot of people have about the life to come in the resurrection, in fact, the Bible even refers to it as the age of the resurrection. It seems somewhere people got the idea that people are just going to be sitting around on clouds, playing with their harps and what have you. And folks, that is not the biblical view of what life in the resurrection age is going to be like. There's going to be work. The difference is it'll be work without the curse of sin on it. It won't be labor, but it'll be enjoyable work. Bible tells us that God Himself works. But what we're going to look at today is what does the Bible require of us as far as just doing work? Believe it or not, that's one of the things that we sometimes don't think about the Bible actually having something to say about it, but it does. Work glorifies Christ. And there's way too many people in our world today that expect or have come to anticipate society providing for us without us doing any work for it. But that concept of the government or society providing for us simply isn't biblical. And even if you buy into that, the question you have to ask yourself is if all of society just sits around waiting on a handout, who's doing the handing out? Somewhere, somebody's got to work. Well, that's what this passage of Scripture actually has to say for us. So, let's look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. We're going to begin with verse 6 and go down through verse 15. As the Apostle Paul writes this to the church at Thessalonica. But we command you, brethren, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you withdraw from every brother who walks disorderly and not according to the tradition which he received from us. For you yourselves know how you ought to follow us. For we were not disorderly among you, nor did we eat anyone's bread free of charge, but worked with labor and toil night and day, that we might not be a burden to any of you. Not because we do not have authority, but to make ourselves an example of how you should follow us. For even when we were with you, we commanded you this: if anyone will not work, neither shall he eat. For we hear that there are some who walk among you in a disorderly manner, not working at all, but are busybodies. Now those who are such, we command and exhort through our Lord Jesus Christ that they work in quietness and eat their own bread. But as for you, brethren, do not grow weary in doing good. And if anyone does not obey our word in this epistle, note that person and do not keep company with him, that he may be ashamed. Yet do not count him as an enemy, but admonish him as a brother. Paul makes it pretty clear here in this passage of Scripture. The church was expected to work. Now, Paul was not addressing those who were indigent or for whatever reason could not work. He's specifically speaking of those who would not work. And there is a difference. And for those who can. There's two main things we see out of this. First off, Paul is admonishing the church there at Thessalonica to practice a spiritual discipline. Not simply a discipline in the sense of punishing one another, but that they were encouraged to be disciplined in their lifestyle, and if necessary, to admonish those who were refusing to work. So practice spiritual discipline. Well, what does that mean? Number one, Paul said to avoid those that were disorderly. And you'll notice in this passage of Scripture that Paul defined being disorderly as simply those who would not work. If we're not working, then there was an assumption that they were probably involved in activities that were ungodly. So avoid those that are disorderly. And in the church today, we need to avoid troublemakers. I don't know where all of you have had experience in churches before, but folks, I'm here to tell you that many churches today have got more than our fair share of people that act ungodly. Church has got troublemakers in it. And one of the reasons so many churches have troublemakers or have to deal with troublemakers is because of the fact we don't pay attention to passages like this and we let folks do these sort of things. Folks, we need to avoid troublemakers. In fact, Paul says not to even socialize with those who are busybodies and gossips. I personally knew of a situation several years ago in a state not too far north of us here that one pastor completely lost his ministry, had nothing to do with anything that he had done, but simply because some people in the church thought something was going on, started a rumor about him, and that rumor spread so quickly that within a month, he had been asked to resign from the church over something that was nothing more than pure gossip, because nobody had the wherewithal to go speak to him. But what started the problem were that those who should have been minding their own business, working and bringing glory to God, were instead busybodies and spreading gossip. Now, before I continue on about the whole idea of gossips and what have you, let me mention this. I know a lot of us men, when we start thinking about busybodies and gossips, we start thinking, oh, I know some old lady in the church that this is exactly what she is. Men, let me remind you, some of the biggest busybodies and gossips in the church are men. And by the way, I see you over there nodding your head. By the way, yeah, I noticed that. Folks, all of us need to be paying attention to that, not to be busybodies and gossips. And by the way, one of the things that I notice a lot of church people like to do is, oh, I'm not gossiping, I'm sharing a prayer request. No, folks, it's just gossip. If you want to share a bona fide prayer request, first off, you go to that individual themselves and discuss it. You don't spread it around everybody else. If it's something that is indeed a prayer request, go to somebody that's a trusted individual and say, look, I need to go confront someone. You don't even have to name names. Folks, God already knows who it is. I need to go see someone and discuss a particular issue. Would you pray for this situation that I will have the wisdom to do it, that the individual will be receptive? You don't have to put names to it. That's how you can share a prayer request. But when you start naming names and saying, well, you know, such and such is doing this and such is doing that, folks, it goes out beyond the issue of being a prayer request, and it's just plain gossip. We need to avoid doing that. In fact, again, as I mentioned, Paul makes it very clear that we are to avoid people that do these kind of things. You know, it's hard to spread gossip if the person that it's being spread to simply chooses to ignore it and not pass it on. The second thing is, Paul tells us, is to warn those that are disobedient. When he says, admonish these as a brother, the word that Paul uses, basically, it doesn't mean to condemn someone or shake your finger at them, but to simply warn them that, hey, there's a problem here. We need to work this out. Share the truth of God's commandments with them. Share with them the passages of Scripture that say, hey, we ought not to be doing this, that we need to be working for God and not working for the enemy. By the way, when we spread gossip and we sit around as busybodies and fail to bring glory to God, we're working all right, but we're working for the wrong company. Share the truth of God's commandments. And by the way, as we do that, don't be afraid of conflict and confrontation. One of the biggest reasons so many churches today have gossips, busybodies, and troublemakers is because when it comes to the attention of those in the church, we simply choose to become ourselves gossips and spread rumors about it and complain about it instead of facing the situation head on. Folks, we need to not be afraid of conflict. And because we think of conflict as being arguments and disagreements. Folks, sometimes you have to confront someone. Jesus himself has given us guidelines for how we deal with problems between each other and with the church. And I've known of people that say, well, that's just not our practice here. We do it this way, or you ought to go and talk to the management or whatever. Folks, the management does not supersede the will of God. If Jesus says we go to that individual first one-on-one, and when that doesn't work, then we go with a witness or two, that is how we deal with it. Don't be afraid of conflict and confrontation. Conflicts and confrontations can be done away with when we're willing to go in a loving manner to someone who's got a problem or who's causing problems. The church would be a whole lot more peaceful. And that's what God wants for us, is to get along in peace. We need to remember one thing in all of that, folks. None of us here are currently living in the age of the resurrection. We are all sinners saved by grace. And every single one of us is subject to living in sin and to having sinful thoughts, sinful problems, And there's going to be conflict. Anytime sin is present, there's going to be issues. And that has been going on since the Garden of Eden. That's why sin is such a bad thing. Is there's no way around it. You've got to confront it and deal with it. And then when we do, reach out in love. Disciple others in Christ's love. Not discipline, mind you, but disciple others in the love of Christ. Paul said, don't count, this is verse 15, don't count him as an enemy, but admonish him as a brother. And that, when Paul said this as a brother, he's including the ladies as well. As a brother, a sister, we ought to go not with the shaking of a finger, but with the reaching out of the hand and arm and say, I'd like to sit down with you and work through an issue. And maybe these individuals who are often spiritually immature, we find that those who are disobedient to Christ, in most cases, if they are bona fide Christians, they are not disobedient out of rebellion. Most of the time we're disobedient because we're still spiritually immature. And what we need is not discipline, but discipling. And that's what the church is for. To disciple one another. By the way, if you're ever looking for a church, the so-called perfect church, I've even had people tell me, I'm still looking for a church. I haven't found one that's just what I'm looking for. I am just trying to find, and they will describe essentially the perfect church. Folks, if you can find the perfect church, the instant one of us sinners walks in the door, it's not perfect anymore. It won't be a perfect church until Jesus comes back. Disciple others in the love of Christ. Reach out in love, not in anger or in discipline. And that's what the concept of practicing spiritual discipline is all about. That's what Paul was talking about. He wasn't writing the church at Thessalonica to shake his finger at them and saying, hey, you folks are all messing up here. He was writing them out of Christian love to try to forestall a problem that he saw developing that he knew existed in the church, but said, we need to deal with this, not in anger, but in the love of Christ. And that brings us to the second big issue that Paul was talking about here. Notice as he opened in this passage of Scripture, he talked about, well, we didn't do anything that we could have because we had the authority, but we didn't make ourselves a burden on you. We didn't take anybody's bread without paying for it. Why? Because we wanted to be an example for you. Folks, we need to be an example. Those who are in leadership positions in the church, those who are maybe more spiritually mature, how are those who are less mature, who are younger in the faith, going to learn unless not only do we disciple them, but they need to see us as an example. Be an example for those. Which means, and this is what Paul's point and the whole passage was, number one, work for a living. Let people see us doing things that are productive for the body of Christ. Now, when I say work for a living, I don't necessarily mean to say that all of us who are retired need to, call the Social Security office and say, well, you need to keep your money because I got to go back to work. I mean, as we get older, sometimes we're physically not capable of it. But even whatever we are capable of doing, folks, we need to be active and doing things that bring glory to God. I don't know about any of you, but as I'm getting older, for some strange reason, I have noticed that the people around me and all of my friends are starting to get old. I just don't know why that is. But what I have noticed is that the people around me that are getting older, as long as we stay active and busy in the body of Christ, most of the time, we stay in generally good health for our age. What I have noticed is that that person who says, I'm retiring, I'm not going to do anything anymore, plops down in his easy chair, gets out the remote, and then sits there, is usually dead pretty quick after that. Because good, hard work keeps us healthy. And hard work glorifies Christ. Going all the way back to the creation itself, God made it clear that He worked for 6 days. Now, we all know that, I mean, in our minds, our spirits, we know that all God had to do is simply think about it, say the word, and creation came into existence. But God talked about working because He was setting an example for us. When He rested on the seventh day, God didn't need any rest. Again, He was setting an example for us. Jesus was condemned many times on the Sabbath day when He dared to say that, well, my Father's working. The Sabbath day isn't here, you know, just for us to serve it. It's for the Sabbath day, God gave it to us to serve us, that we would have a day of rest with the expectation that if one day is a day of rest, guess what we're doing the rest of the time? We're working, bringing glory to God. We need to be providing for our own needs. I don't know about you folks, but one of the things that I find most irritating, especially when I drive to Gainesville, is how many times you see panhandlers out on the corners, you know, will work for food, homeless, disabled, got this problem, got that problem. You know, if they spent half as much time looking for a job as they do standing on the street corner doing this, they'd probably have a job. Provide for our own needs. Don't expect the world around us to do it for us. Many Christian groups seem to think that it glorifies God to get the world to finance their various ministries. We see this, of course, at Christmas time. And folks, it's not just the Salvation Army. There are a lot of various groups that are always looking for the world to donate to our ministries. But your problem is, you know what the world sees in that? They see that, well, there's just another church out begging for money. That's the image the world gets. That's why it glorifies God for us to support ourselves. Don't be a burden to others. Well, that means don't take advantage of others. And don't abuse the goodwill of other people. Now, that doesn't mean sometimes Christians don't have genuine needs and we as a church exist. We are here to support one another. If a bona fide need exists, then certainly we as a church should band together and support one another. But that's when there is a bona fide need, maybe because of a handicap, because of, you know, person is indigent, they're too old, whatever the issue is, maybe they've got health problems. I'm talking about that is different versus someone who simply will not work. When we are capable of it, we should be supporting the church. The Apostle Paul even made very specific guidelines for even what constituted the widows in the church, that if you're young and you're capable of continuing on, said, you don't count as one of the widows of the church that needs the support of the church. He said, those who are simply too old, too indigent, their health was bad. He said, those are the ones that we should be supporting as a church. Well, what do the rest do? We need to be working, glorifying God. I don't see it very often anymore, once in a blue moon. But back when all of us were younger, it used to be very common that pastors of churches, and being as I are one, I can criticize them for this. Pastors of churches used to go around every time they'd go to the pharmacy or some particular type of, you know, a hardware store, wherever it was, especially small, local, independently owned places. They'd always be asked, well, do you have a ministerial discount? I never asked for one. Even places that I know that still do offer such, I refuse to ask for one. Here's the reason why. When we as the church expect people to treat us differently, to give us a break, to not charge us as much, what we are teaching the world is that we, the church, are not capable of handling our own affairs. We're too poor or too messed up. Folks, we are here in the world representing God Almighty. The world needs to see in us that the church takes care of its own. We, the church, are willing to work for a living. That's one of the reasons why when every time he was asked about paying taxes, Jesus was, you know, very adamant about it, that the church needs to be good citizens. We need to pay our taxes so that when the government would look at us, they would know that we are indeed, you know, holding our own, that we are not dependent on the government for our support. Now, here in this country, the church itself, legally speaking, is exempt from taxation. But that's not because we're asking for it. That's simply because the government decided that it didn't want money supporting the government, local or otherwise, coming from the church. But what we do need to do is, as individuals, pay our taxes, be good citizens, and bring glory to God. Then, persevere in ministry. Notice what Paul says here in verse 13. He says, as for you, brethren, do not grow weary in doing good. Because he knew that there was, you know, it was easy to get down and to just want to throw the towel in, say, hey, I'm tired. I'm just going to stay home. I'm going to quit working. I'm just going to depend on everybody else's goodwill. He said, no, don't get discouraged. Don't get discouraged in doing good, but continue to be an example. That is what God has called us to do. And that's why he tells us good, hard work glorifies God, because it shows the world that this is what being a Christian is all about, is we glorify God and that we serve Him. We are here to serve the King of Kings. I finish with this. Folks, hard work does glorify God, and it makes us good examples of Christ, not only in the world, but to the world. We are far better witnesses for Christ when people see us working for a living and supporting ourselves. Consider this. Have you ever stopped some guy on the street corner that says, I'm homeless, I'm out of work, give me a handout, and ask him if he, you know, can you tell me about Jesus? There's an assumption that he probably doesn't, or she, doesn't know Jesus. Because God called us to work and support ourselves. If anything, we need to stop that guy on the street corner and ask, said, you know, don't have any money to give you, but here's what I do have. Do you know Jesus? Let's stand as we pray. Our Father in heaven, help us, Lord, to be good witnesses, to be hardworking. Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit. And Lord, as we do become tired, physically weary, Lord, give us the strength of your Holy Spirit. Help us, Lord, to share with others the love of Christ and to be the examples you've called us to be, that through it all, Lord, your kingdom would be grown and the name of Jesus glorified. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And I ask if you turn in your hymn books to hymn number 545 as we sing Living for Jesus, hymn number 545. ask if you would be seated, and if... No, you two don't get to seat. Celebrate the Lord's Supper together. And as a reminder, the only requirement that we have as a church to celebrate together is that you are indeed a believer in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. But in accordance with Paul's admonishment to us, none of us here are worthy of this table. But he says that we should come to the table in a worthy manner. So as we sit and contemplate over this, just be sure that each one of us is right before the Savior that we're celebrating this morning. Jesus celebrated the Passover dinner with his disciples. He told them that he wanted to celebrate it together. They asked him, well, how are we going to do this? And he gave them very specific instructions as to where to go, what would happen, and what to prepare. I find it rather interesting that every single detail of what was going to happen leading up to the crucifixion of Christ and everything after that, Jesus knew in detail what was going to happen. He knew the pain that he was about to endure as he was going to be nailed to the cross. He wanted to celebrate together with his disciples. But even knowing that, and as he celebrated together, he held up that unleavened bread. He said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." He knew what was coming. And yet, even though the human, the man within him, was struggling over it, he was obedient to the will of his Father and went through it because God loves us. We celebrate together. I'm going to ask Brother Larry, you would lead us in a prayer. We celebrate the bread.
Our dear Lord, we just come before you praising you for your perfect salvation. Thank you for giving us Jesus. Thank you, Father, for this opportunity to celebrate. And we just give you all praise and glory. I ask you in that name of Jesus.
Jesus took the bread. Said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." Likewise, he took the cup. Said, "This is my blood of the new covenant." Now, to have a new covenant, that's the same thing as saying a new will, a new testament. That's actually the reason why in our Bibles today, we refer to one as the Old Testament and the other as the New Testament. Because Jesus said, "In this cup, my blood is the new covenant, the New Testament." Well, in order to effect the fulfillment of a will, of a testament, somebody has to die. And again, Jesus went to the cross willingly, knowing that he was going to shed his blood and give his life for us. Brother Stan, you lead us.
Dear Lord, we just thank you for this time to worship you. We thank you for sending your Son down to the Spirit to walk and spread the word, dear Lord. And sent to the cross and shed his blood for us, dear Lord. And now send us, dear Lord.
Took the cup and said, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you." As we stand together, as we have our benediction, and don't forget that right after this, continue with our Bible study over at the house. Brother Lou, would you lead us in a benediction?
Father, thank you for bringing us all together here in fellowship. Died for us.